ETF. And look at that, that's an alternate Twisted Fate ban, which tells me, you know, their first pick, they've only got that one single pick. Even though they probably would play TF, he's not going to be their priority.
Thresh is still available as well, so it wouldn't surprise me that as a first pick, Alternate decides to go, we like Thresh, we like Jerry playing Thresh, so let's go with it. And against MYM, he actually prevented First Blood on Creatine with some awesome Dark Passage Lantern gank. So that's probably where my feeling's going.
And Nunu has been taken out as a third and final ban here for MYM. Been a bit of a terror with Aranea in that jungle. First pick, though, is going to be, surprise, surprise, Shen.
So Shen available, that's going to go straight to Kerb. He's going to try to redo what he did to Evil Geniuses, survive a 1v3 tower dive and pick up First Blood himself. I'm thinking about Libic, and when I think about Thresh, he has played it, and he did play last weekend as well. He stacked a load of HP. He went Giant's Belt, double Ruby Crystal, had like 2.5 or 2,800 HP, and it looks like he's going to be recreating it.
Yeah, I'm going to go for that one. And Makata taking that Nautilus that he's enjoyed playing so much in the jungle. Let's not forget here that Elise is open, and Kubon has been fantastic with Elise. Of course, I did say that Meaty Makers earlier on beat Fnatic. The correction, of course, would that be they beat EG, not Fnatic. That would be my mistake. Kind of flustered there as the camera switched to us while I'm drinking my water. But you know, it's all good. Alternate right now then on their second round of picks. AD carry maybe coming in this round of picks because of that Ezreal ban. Alternate may want to secure that for Creatine.
It's definitely a possibility. We know Jerry has also been playing a fair amount of Nami as well, so that might be something to consider. Aranea was sitting on Lee Sin, and he has played Lee Sin before, but I feel like his impact in games is higher or more powerful with the likes of Hecarim. So we'll see what he does decide to lock in. If it is going to be this Lee, he has had some very good ganks, does like to buy that Ruby Sightstone and try to pull off some insect level plays in terms of dashing around the map and kicking his opponents into his enemies.
Yeah, and they'll be matching that up with the Varus for Creatine. Doesn't seem to matter what Creatine gets his hands on. This guy is a machine. So, what are MYM going to go with this next round? We talked about Elise already for Kubon, and Charu's actually hovering over that. They're going to leave their middle laner till last by looks of things. That was a quick switch out there to Ryze.
So that's probably going to be a top lane Ryze. And the reason I say that, I think they want to leave that last pick, that counter pick for Charu in the end. In addition, Kubon is sitting on that flash teleport. Now, Elise may have been a stronger matchup against Shen. Would have been able to just keep him lower, keep him on the back foot. Now, Ryze can do well as the game goes on. The early level, Shen's going to have the advantage, going to have slightly more damage to put out, and obviously not being reliant on mana will play into his favor quite nicely.
So Alternate then on their final round of picks here. What are we going to see from them? Sat currently with Fiddlesticks, which we have seen Jerry play before. Got one win under his belt with it as well, so a definite possibility there. And Creatine looking like he might be picking up a Katarina for Ferelden Lore.
So that's actually a very good pick, because right now, the dredge line from Thresh, the pull from Nautilus and his ultimate are the only things that would interrupt, maybe the Flay as well. So if he does pick his engagement well and can jump over Thresh or Nautilus in team fights, he can get a very, very good Death Lotus up. There's no other interruptions. In the end of the last couple seconds, though, he does swap over to Ahri and goes back to champion that he did so incredibly well with in the promotion series. Yep. Charu did so incredibly well with yesterday. It was a charming performance, as D-Man would say, and we'll see whether or not he can counter the Nine-Tailed Fox.
Well, let's have a look then. I mean, that Ryze was locked in earlier on. Always a possibility, of course, of having that anyway in the middle. Syndra, though, is a champion that we've already seen played here for Meet Your Makers. And Charu, again, showing his mastery of some of those weirder champions. I think he was the one that really first brought out Xerath in Europe. He was playing a lot of that online. So it wouldn't surprise me whatsoever to see that Syndra coming down.
I also like the pick. The problem is when we did see it, he ran it with Teleport, and you and I were both quite critical about the use of Teleport. If he had Ignite, it would have been 3 or 4 more kills, and I personally would like to see him going that route. But against a Varus, a Fiddle, and a Ahri, if he gets his combo off first, he'll insta-give them. If, however, he does not, Ahri's going to jump away, he's going to get silenced and feared by Fiddle, and Varus is just going to hit his ulti and just walk to safety. So it's whoever sees whomever first will then win.
Well, if we look at the Meaty Makers lineup currently, they're sat on 2 teleports there, one with Kubon, and it wouldn't be the first time that we've seen Ryze with a teleport. It's a fairly common thing to have. Of course, Alex Itch in the Spring Split was doing that fairly regularly in the early stages, but to have 2 teleports in one team is something that we don't see very often.
And this is something that MYM will need to use very effectively. We've seen Charu actually using his teleport to prevent dives, to save towers, to prolong the life of towers. And if done in that regard, yeah, you're not winning objectives with it, but if you're defending objectives, you're denying 1,000 gold to your opponent effectively if you can make that work. Cubone on Ryze is not going to be much kill potential against a Shen, especially in the early levels, unless Nautilus comes to gank. So that might mean, hey, let's ward up heavily on the bottom lane, teleport in behind them, and have a, you know, four-man party. Even if Shen joins, it's still going to be a numbers advantage because we have two global summoner spells.
So we're going to get into gaming here shortly. Alternate versus Meet Your Makers for the top spot in the European LCS Summer Split. Both of these teams got off to a great start last weekend over in Jönköping, Sweden at the DreamHack. And now they're here on stage in Moscow, which Alternate, you know, not had the best of luck on so far. They lost that game yesterday to Gambit Gaming, which we've already talked about it. They had a 1,600 strong audience behind them.
To be fair, they still put up a hell of a fight.
Yes, it is.
For the longest time, that game was very, very even. It was very close, and only towards the latter stages did Gambit really get that massive crowd helping them snowball to victory. And if Alternate can at least channel similar levels of play and perform as they did last week, they might be able to shut down MYM.
So here we go then. We are going to get into game. What can we expect here from level one? You know, we've got the hooks coming out there. We've got charms from Frelenlord, the taunt from Kerp.
So basically, because of the hooks, I think Alternate may want to play a little bit defensively. If J-Ree does go for Dark Wind, the silence, it is a very powerful silence because it'll bounce between multiple members of MYM, and that silence is, it's one of the most frustrating crowd control effects to deal with. Does look like they're stacking up right now. Oh. They're actually going to be the ones that are moving in, that Sonic Wave just missing.
Yeah, just going in there, skimming past Makata, who was a little bit lucky for all of that, to be fair. And in the end, it doesn't connect, which he just walks away from and says, well, that's a good thing. Ward down by Red Bush in the Red Bush, and a ward over by the Golems as well.
That's a very good ward in the Golems, more so than the Red Bush, because you can almost estimate the time that Nautilus will be doing his jungle if you assume he's going a standard route. However, by putting it down on the double Golems, for example, now Libic and Makata can have no idea that that ward is there, so they'll be able to have full knowledge and understanding of where Makata is in the jungle.
There was a laugh.
I take it back. Maybe he does know the ward's there.
There was a laugh afterwards straight away from Libby because he takes down the other ward and the crowd give a cheer. That's what you call playing up to the crowd, ladies and gents. So, pretty standard start by the looks of things here. Kubon right now is going to be doing the wolves with Charu. You see the three-man start up by the Golems. Nothing really to write home about. Crits and Jerry doing the Golems themselves.
We do see the lane swap from MYM, so you're 100% right. It's now the standard, as in your duo for red side is now going top. And I tell you what, Cubone's Ryze is going to be so tested this game, because if he gets caught by a hail of arrows into a fear, into a dark wind, he's going to be silenced, he's going to be feared, and there's going to be so much time to put damage down. That little bit of luck factor in which way the fear sends you could literally determine whether or not he dies or not.
Yep. Couldn't get lucky, and it fears you under your turret. Can be really unlucky, and it feeds you straight into the champions that are going at you. So we'll have to see how that one all develops here. And also, that middle lane is going to be another interesting one, just for the fact that it's Frelenlord playing the Ahri this time around. Charu going for his less conventional, less seen Syndra, but a champion that we know can put out insane amounts of burst damage.
And both of the champions reliant on landing all of their abilities, ideally on, you know, single targets. Syndra's got a little bit more splash, a little bit more area of effect damage, which plays into her favor. So the miss chance is a little bit more wider, as it were. Whereas Ahri, it's a single target skill shot. If you go like a millimeter off, it doesn't land, you don't get your damage.
And there we just see half of Kubon's health gone. That's a single piercing arrow with the Dark Wind flying through onto him as well. Not exactly the easiest lane that he's ever going to face here. But on the same time, you know, Kerp, with that Shen, is going to be in that 1v2 lane as well. So we'll see how that goes. Right now, Makata coming down to this bottom lane. Not really a chance of a gank. It's more of a pressure-relieving duty that he's going to take from this one.
Yeah, just keep him, you know, as healthy as possible. But you see how powerful that Dark Wind is. It goes in range of Makata just as he's trying to land the likes of that Riptide. Just drop the HP of those minions if possible. Unfortunately, it doesn't work out for him. Right now, though, 4-10, a very good taunt. Look at the top.
Oh, RNA are actually coming in onto that one as well. He's going to get hooked up here. He's got the double buff. He can't afford to lose this right now. The Ignite is ticking away. He does have that shield. He's going to be able to walk away from this one, but not with much health left.
No, that shield actually saved his life there. He dropped down to 45 HP, and the shield is a literally 40 HP shield. That was true damage of Ignite that potentially would have burned through that one. So managing to keep himself alive, but Aranea underestimating the damage of his opponents, and Kuban with a teleport in this bottom lane.
Yeah, getting in there. And one thing we should note from Meet Your Maker's side, as we'll note that in a second here, because Jayree is in all kinds of trouble. He actually has to flash away from this one. Kuban going to flash in on top of him. Does he have the damage? No, nor the speed to catch up with him. And that first blood still waits.
Yeah, the speed of Ryze at low level is very, very difficult to deal with. 345 base. He was unable to close the distance between himself and Jayree, but Makata hasn't had enough yet, just missing Fiddlesticks.
Yeah, Creighton actually was locked up in the room prison there. Makata is still hanging around here, soaking up the XP from the lane, and we will surely be seeing him go back. 17 CS at Ryze Kuban has right now. Compare that to Kerb, and it's a big difference.
Yeah, it's mostly just trying to help him out, and of course, if Jayree and Creighton are now afraid of the ganks or lower on HP, it means they're less likely to get very, very aggressive. In the mid lane, Frenilor dropped incredibly low by Charu Syndra.
Yeah, he's not quite, in fact, both of them not quite up to level 6 just yet, so no ultimate available. Aranea is actually heading down, so we'll see if Charu actually gets baited into going for that low HP man, and in the end, it will just be Aranea doing a bit of counter jungling, trying to get rid of those rakes.
Now, it's very good for Charu because he doesn't have Ignite. He needs to get his opponent low like that before he can actually pick up a kill, and he's about to hit level 6. Double-checking his XP, maybe this wave should be enough to actually get him there, so we'll see if he does decide to go in. Puts a decent amount of damage onto Aranea, and he just dashes away to safety.
Yeah, landing skill shots onto Elysian is never been the easiest thing in the world. There's the fear coming down onto Makata as the hook has landed here. On towards Kerp in that top lane. Do they have enough damage to take him? No, and not enough HP to risk going under that tower as they lost sight of Aranea as well.
Really good control from Libic. Not only did he land the death sentence, he waited until Kerp started to walk away. Then he used the flay. So he didn't stack the abilities on top of one another. And it's one of the most important things to learn is as and when to use that crowd control, getting the absolute maximum out of it, and it's allowing them to keep Shen a little bit lower down. He's still, you know, 10, 11 CS behind, and with a big wave in front of Ryze, he should be able to extend that even further. And more importantly, his tower's about to fall.
Yeah, Meet Your Maker's going to have the first tower of the game here, just 6.5 minutes in. Fantastic push play from them. And maybe open things up now for Shen to get a little bit more CS back into this. He's now 13 or 12, if I could actually read the screen. Now it's 13. I've covered my back from that one. Makata is still down there at the bottom, though. He's going to just dredge line back onto the turret to make sure that he doesn't get caught out. For Ellen Lord had come down as well, so maybe have a little bit of a look at some action.
Yeah, there were too many minions there, so even though the both Fiddle and Varus were overextended, they couldn't afford to engage and lose that massive wave of experience and potential gold. In the mid lane, Charu flashes the taunts.
Yep, and the charm landing, missing there as well from Pharrell and Lauren. I want to go back to my other point. Because we've got those two teleports in there here for Meet Your Makers, there's only a single Ignite and no Exhaust since Graves has, in fact, got in for that cleanse, no barrier, as we see over with Creighton. So see if that could actually come back to bite them later on when we've got a man chasing or they're chasing for that fact.
So there's things that are good and bad about that. The good thing is the only target that they'd want to really exhaust would be the likes of Varus, of course. Lower his attack damage, lower his attack speed. Lee Sin and Shen not necessarily known for that AD. In the mid lane, though, Acharu's going aggressive.
Yeah, and this could be bad news because we are going to see Stan United coming in as well. And it will come down from Kerb. Didn't really need it in the end, but it is Pharrell and Lord that picks up that first blood. And now Alternate, they've come in at the perfect time here to stop Meet Your Makers doing Dragon.
Great timing on that pressure. That actually got started by Charu being jumped on by Aranea. He tried to turn the tables, and if it had not been for that Stand United shield, Aranea would have gone down. So very good play and communication from Alternate. It looked like they were considering going onto the Dragon, but decided against it because Graves is very close to level 6, will actually just hit it, and definitely would have been a high damage threat for that burst combination.
So if you look at the goal, it's actually quite curious considering where we're at. Obviously, 1-0 in kills, but the first turret going to Meet Your Makers. Now, look at the CS as well. 67-52 between the two AD carries. 50-28 between the solo tops, and 57-46 there in the mid lane. So overall, Meet Your Makers are doing a fantastic job at keeping that farm up.
Well, MYM have been a little bit more in control of their laning phase. I mean, if you think about the top lane, Makla and Libic had complete control on Kerb Shen. In the mid lane, Charu was poking down front end, or he was low at 20% HP for a while. And in the bottom lane, you of course had Cubone being looked after by Mokate's Nautilus in those early stages. The thing that they need to do, though, is convert that advantage to more objectives. They've got one tower, but they'll need more, a dragon, or maybe some kills to really make that stick and become permanent.
Yep, and now that we've got this 2v2 lane, things could get really, really interesting. A hook here, or now an aggressive Kriatan, which we've certainly become more and more accustomed to, throwing out his ultimate to lock down Meet Your Makers, could change things, especially since Fiddlesticks, you know, even without any AP build, he can still put down a lot of damage with that ultimate.
Yeah, and you see how much damage there Makla just took there in the bottom lane. So he took a tower hit, I assumed the Darkwind bouncing the full five times between the two of them, and a piercing arrow. And he's been forced to drink through those potions. He still doesn't have sustain outside of that Doran's. Jerry's trying to set up for a good Crow Storm, but pretty sure MYM are going to be aware of Fiddlesticks tactics.
Yes, I should imagine so. And actually, he's just missed the ultimate down there, but Charu and Ferelinor going head-to-head in this one. But there is the move from Aranea, gives Ferelinor the shield, and that will be a second kill for Ferelinor on towards Charu in that middle lane.
So in the bottom lane, Kriatan and Jayri try to make a play happen. Crowstorm, as well as that Chain of Corruption, was used, and Makla and Libic only losing a little bit of HP between them. It's not all that much, and they have their ultimate still up.
So things may just settle down now, and they may not, who knows. Let's have a look at the items between those two mid lanes. See double Doran's Ring and the Tear coming in for Charu on Syndra. That just shows you that he's having to stack those Doran's Rings, not being able to go any real, really any further than that. On the other side, though, the Chalice and that Finnish Codex already picked up here by Ferelinor.
And Ferelinor doing his sort of standard Ahri build where he opens with double Fairy Charm. Libic may flash Chain. I know that Libic actually says thanks to Krepo for teaching him how to do the flash death sentence. And the way he was poising there in lane, it would have been a perfect, perfect setup. They might maybe wait for Makata to come play. The fear is on. Here comes Aranea.
Wow, they are going to go in. There's the kickback. The box down by Limic, but he's not going to save him here. He is a dead man, and it's Kriatan that picks up the kill. But here come the rest of Meet Your Makers. They've already got themselves one. Great taunt coming out of Kerb. May just be able to keep them alive with this one. Meet Your Makers have to back off. One
so
for one.
Trade one for one, but two teleports used as well as that Stand United. At any moment, this becomes a massive, massive party because everybody is so incredibly mobile. MYM pick up their very first kill thanks to that teleport coming down from Cubone, and now they have the numbers advantage as they try to siege up this bottom lane tower.
Will they be able to do it there? Ferelinor, in the meantime, will be pushing through the middle lane, so they need to be a little bit worried about how that one's going to go. There's a stun on towards Aranea, but those minions taken away very, very quickly here by Meet Your Makers, and that halts MYM in their tracks. Meanwhile, Ferelinor is still pushing that middle lane out, and he's just got a fresh wave of minions there.
So he's going to be able to do a lot of damage. Actually, with that minion wave, he may even be able to take it down. What is going to happen for Alternate, it's going to take about 2 minutes and 10 seconds for that Stand United to become available, and it's going to be about 3.5 or 4 minutes for the teleports. So we do see Charu getting taunted up, depth charges out, but Jerry's going to get to safety. What it means for Alternate, they've got that 1 minute window where they can challenge with the use of that Stand United and not be caught out.
Oh, there's Aranea again, hooked in actually by Makata, but doesn't, of course, have that depth charge available. It's going to mean that Aranea can get away. There's a ward down for Ferelinor. He's coming around the back. This could spell trouble for Meet Your Makers. He does have his ultimate and a flash available if he needs to get properly involved in this one. He's a little bit wary, though, of Charu off to the side, and in the end, he decides, let's recall, let's play this one safe. We've taken the mid turret, and Kriatan most likely is going to have this top turret away.
The one thing that I really like about Charu's champion choice here in this matchup, Syndra has the ability to do a five-man stun. If she gets a very good scatter of the weak, knocks those balls of power into her opponents, she can stun every single one of them that's hit. What that means is if Charu is on form and firing like he was yesterday, he has the potential to completely, completely turn team fights in his favor. So we'll have to keep an eye on that. He is 0-2, but that's thanks to very good ganks from Aranea, not necessarily bad play from Charu.
Aranea currently sat with 3 assists, as does Kerb have two. Both actually coming in from using his ultimate to get involved. And the Ruby Sightstone picked up as well now for RNA, which, now, an important part, I think, of any good Lee Sin's kit there, to have enough wards to really use your mobility to its full potential.
And not only that, all of the bonuses that gives you, it's not just for him moving around. It's also going to allow every member of Ultimate to make more informed decisions. So MYM with this one tower advantage, if they start grouping like they are now, they will be able to see it. Blue buff actually went to Makate. He flashed and smited for that. They really didn't want Ferelden Lord having that additional power.
Yeah, really putting a lot into that one. We can see that Shen gone for Giant Spell here, but a Hex Drinker as well coming out from Kerb. So that is double AP after all. So not quite not really the biggest surprise here, but the fact is he's not going full on tankiness here.
Yeah, it's a very non-traditional item, especially on somebody like Shen. The attack damage is going to benefit him, but you tend to see a little bit more focus maybe on some attack speed, which is why Wit's End was so popular in Season 2. You get his passive up a little bit more, get those key strikes down. Right now, though, Ultimate, they've grouped up as four. They want to reply the blue buff steal of their own, and it does look like that goes to Ferelden Lord. So that flash was not used, but there's Creatine Court.
Oh, he's caught out completely in a horrible place here. Stan United's going to come in, but he goes down to the depth charge from Makata, and I'm not sure if they can pull one back. Yes, they can. It's Ferelden Lord that gets that. Jiri will die, but look at Ferelden Lord. He's right in the midst of
Amir. He's caught.
He does land a charm, but he is going to get caught up and finished off by Ryze. Double kill, Kubon.
So they trade 1-for-3 in that engagement, and so crucial, killing Creatine before the Stand United finishes channeling. So Shen left alone up in that top lane. That window that we talked about of Stand United, that was exactly it. Aranea's coming in, he doesn't steal it.
And he's dead. Yeah, comes in there with the Q over the side. It was kind of an all or nothing move, honestly, from Aranea there. And he was just a little bit too slow to actually get himself over. And I have to say, I think if I'm not mistaken, that Aranea is the biggest stealer that we've seen so far. We've seen him taking, I think, 2 or 3 dragons at DreamHack himself. So now he's definitely up there. I don't have on paper the official.
Was he not stealing the blue buffs as well from EG, if I recall correctly? Just walking in and smiting it. It might have been Makata, but yeah, he's doing incredibly well, performing a lot more consistently than we've seen out of Aranea towards the end of Season 2. And in that fight, in that engagement, because they knew that the teleports weren't down, Ultimate made a power play. They're like, we know we've got Stand United. We know they stole our blue buff. There's no smite. There's no flash from Makate. So let's go take theirs. And first of two teleports has been used for a whole lot of CS.
Yeah, man. Creatine is there. He's trying to get that turret down here. Jiri's going to be coming in from the side. Let's see if they can actually lock down Charu with this one. Here he goes in there. He knows that he's going to get a silence off at least. So what's the worst that could happen?
He basically does that awkward fiddle waddle into lane. Good stun onto Ferelden Lord, changing a little bit of damage, but the charms on Charu, he's low.
Yeah, down to half HP. Hadn't put out quite the amount of damage that his opponent put in there. But look at this already. The ward war that's going on. There are so many on the map at this point.
And this is something both teams did fantastically well at DreamHack against other opponents. They controlled their vision very, very well. If you look at Ultimate's wards down towards Dragon, I mean, that's the entire Dragon River, as well as blue buff, as well as entry toward Wolves. There's one defensive ward from MYM, which is fantastic. It's what they didn't do last week. And it's basically what cost them a lot of kills where they could have avoided them.
Well, let's have a look while we've got a possible quiet few minutes. I'll say possible because you never quite know when this game's going to really heat up. We've seen the Rod of Ages picked up for Shen and the Infinity Edge there for Graves. You can compare that to the Blade of the Ruin King done now for Varus and that Hex Drinker Giant Spell combo that we talked about earlier for Shen.
So when this build does eventually get towards completion and Kerb's got a lot of HP and he picks up something like that, more of Malmortius, it's definitely going to help him be a bit more of a damage threat, which is great for Ultimate, but not necessarily the strongest. Ferelden Lord is hooked up, does get a Rune Prison, and that's basically one of the problems. He got the first dash of the Ultimate up before the Rune Prison went down, and he was just locked up after that first cast. It's difficult to lock Ari down.
Yes, definitely is. But at least forcing that Ultimate to come out there, which is not the longest of cooldowns anyway, but still a cooldown. Nonetheless, as many makers stack themselves up as 5 here by that middle turret, will they be able to take it down with this push though?
It doesn't look like it, primarily because of how well Ultimate are defending that one. The Piercing Arrow, good for wave clear, Dark Wind powerful, as well as Ari. Her Orb of Deception, the Q, just spams through and clears waves out very, very well. Got that Athene's Unholy Grail, and I'm not quite sure if this is going to go straight into a Void Staff. but it's either going to be that or a Rylai's Crystal Scepter. So additional HP or additional penetration, depending on how Forelia Lord feels. As right now, MYM are finally sieging up. RNA has been hit.
Yeah, putting a lot of damage down there as Forelia Lord getting involved as the ulti comes out off Kreatum, but a flash away from Makata will actually lead him to safety. And again, a lot used in one big fight that ends with no kills.
And Makata panicked there. The dark passage was right in front of him. All he had to do was click the lantern. It's on the loading screen if you read it. Click the lantern. That's a flash hook!
Yeah, that is a flash hook as the box go down as well. For Ellen Lord caught out. Death charge coming in onto Kreatin. He could be going down from this one as well, using his barrier. Charu coming in from the
Boom.
Side. Unloads for a double kill. And that is a 3-for-1 with them only losing their support.
What was so great from Charu, he realized how low Kreatin was. He used that ultimate unleashed power on Jay Ree. Now Makla's going after Aranea.
Yeah, but he is Lee Sin, a slippery person that he is. Always a pain, is that Lee Sin. And a lot of people hate Lee Sin. I don't think he's justified. Makla here on Makata.
Real talk with Joe Miller.
Not going to hold back on that one. Tori is going to go down. And that will be the third one of the game for Meaty Makers. Incidentally, tied on turrets
and
here
thanks,
with Ultimate.
All thanks to Libic.
Yeah.
Libic was recalling. He was low on HP, and he's seen an opportunity. He realized there was no enemy minions between him and Forelia Lord. He did a flash chain, and even though Forelia Lord had his flash up, he did not expect that aggression. I didn't expect that aggression. Landed the flash hook, held Forelia Lord in place. That made Kreatin stick around, which meant the depth charge followed him for 10 years. And looks like up in the top lane, Forelia Lord's gone on Charu.
A big 1v1 here is going to come out on top of this one. Right now it's looking like Forelia Lord. Charu is going very, very low. Couldn't quite get him down. And that will be Forelia Lord pretty much saying, well, I can do this kind of thing, especially when he's got his ultimate available.
He dodged practically everything.
Yeah,
I think Forelia Lord ate one ability, you know, one of those little balls being tossed at him. Everything else, he literally hopped, skipped, and jumped away from. So very, very good positional play from Forelia Lord to not only survive the engagement, to pick up kills of for himself. Makata is a little bit late.
Yeah, just a little bit. And now he could be in trouble here as he gets taunted up. He's going to dredge line half a way away, but we have got Aranea coming in. Can he get in front? He can if he uses the flash like that, but I don't think they've really got the damage, especially not Kerb there. And now they're going to try and turn this one around onto Aranea. This could be really, really bad. There is the collateral damage used. They hook Kerb in as well. Can Kerb get away from this one? Actually, Makla came away with a lantern in that scenario. They're a little bit scared of a rebuttal from Alternate.
Good play from Libic as well to put the shield down. If the kill had landed, he would have picked himself up an assist in that particular engage. So good awareness on that one. Dragon will be coming up in 5 seconds' time, and Meaty Makers are making it very clear they know. Oh, the hook misses on Jay Ree. Makata, that was wide. He pulled it, and the anchor didn't land.
But the dragon is there. Meaty Makers are going to start things off. They spot that ward at the back there, just finished off by Libic. Alternate now working their way in. He's going to be taken down. The hook will land actually on towards Jerry, and they're going to go for this one for Unload. Still at the back, biding his time here until they get a little bit lower. Jerry going to go down in the end to Makla. Here comes Aranea finally back into the fight. Makata is going very, very low. Will falter for Unload. Kubon may suffer the same fate. Yes, he will. Double kill for Unload. Kreatin is there at the side. Stan United used. That keeps him alive and gives him the kill on towards Graves. Can they now getting all towards Charu, who turns it around himself, but I don't think that he's going to be able to escape this one. Not now as the Q lands, and it's actually Kerp in the end with a Vorpal Blade that finish off, and that is an ace for Alternate for just one death.
What a fantastic fight from Alternate. I have to question Charu using his ultimate in that particular fight on Kerp. He did not have Aranea or Forelia Lord or Kreatin to hit with Unleashed Power, and he used it on Shen. You cannot afford to use that ultimate on a non-damage dealing target. You cannot hit the tank with it. So they end up losing all of their members. They did pick up Dragon, but that's not worth it because it does look like they're going to lose yet another blue buff.
That blue buff is going to be belonging to Forelia Lord here. So let's have a bit of a stock take and see what we've got here. 32.3 to 32.6 thousand gold. Pretty much bang on even. Turrets are even. Kills are 11 to 9. That's pretty even as well. And if you look at the spread, 4 for the AD carry, 6 for Ahri, 1 for Shen in that top lane. On the other side, 4 for Ryze, 2 for Syndra, 2 for Graves.
This is the game we wanted last weekend.
Yeah.
This is the game we were expecting when we had 4-0 and 4-0 because both teams were just playing so confidently and so, you know, they were on their game. And it looks like MYM just faltered a little bit at DreamHack. Now, they had the early pressure, they're still in control of the gold, and they're still moving around the map as if it's their plays to make. And as long as they don't lose that confidence, they're still in a good position. But it's all going to depend on these upcoming fights, because obviously the later we go, the more damage and the more it's going to actually impact your team.
So here's Creason down at the bottom. Needs to be careful here as the Lantern comes in. This is going to be a big push as he gets the ultimate down. Great taunt coming in. There is a teleport as well from Meteor Makers coming down here. They have seen Syndra go down and they may lose Livik from this one. Livik does get that kill on towards Creator. Well, there was Aranea in the Tribush ready and waiting. Now it's going to be Makler versus Ferelden Lord. Can he get in there? He's already used the active. Actually, I'm telling a lie. He's the one with the Infinity Edge, not with the Blade of the Ruin King. Stop making things up, Joe. He had the red buff, which it was that got the slowdown onto Ferelden.
He's still got his ulti.
And he still does have his ultimate, but he might not need it because he's got Kuban here. Flash over from Ferelden Lord. There is the move away from Makler, and this should be a dead Ferelden Lord if they can actually land things onto him.
He's done a great job of it. One more overload, that should be him to go down. Now, I want to ask Kuban. Oh, Krosor misses completely. Jerry was anticipating Ryze to continue the chase. But what Ryze did in that previous engagement, he cancelled his teleport to the bottom lane. Now, it eventually led to Kuban picking up a kill, which is great for Kuban, but his team ended up losing that engagement quite significantly. They lost two on the bottom lane for one, and they picked up one in reply in the top lane. But I'd love to know from Kuban, why did he cancel the teleport? Was it a team call? Did he realize he could kill Ari? Was it just that he knew the bottom lane was lost? There were so many possibilities for why he decided to do that, and ends up putting him 5-1-3. He's sort of the hard carry that MYM are going to look to.
So right now, Makata and Livik headed up towards his top side. Aranea is in their jungle right now, and Makata's going to get a swift kick. Can he get away from this one? Jerry actually coming in there, and in the end, he gets pulled back to the middle by the Lantern. Should stay safe from that one, but now that's the kick down for a little while for Aranea at least. He's not going to be able to get in there and cause trouble with that.
Yeah, it's not the longest of cooldowns, so even at rank 2, which it is now, it's a little over a minute in terms of cooldown, so you're quite happy spamming it out, and I really like the idea. Kick Makata into Fiddlesticks. Fiddlesticks will then fear in silence, and the theory is then someone will kill him, but there was no one else around, so they simply didn't have the damage to burst out Makata, who's fairly beefy with that Aegis the Ninja Tab, but he's got quite high resistances right now.
There's a blue buff for Ferelden Lord. Obviously, he had his last one stolen away, then stole the enemy blue buff. So, that blue buff of his been pretty highly contested so far. Meteor Makers here just trying to steal away that big Wraith. And there's going to be a battle for it. I thought Livik was getting ready to throw that hook there over the side. In the end, decides not to. Makata actually throwing the hook out as well, which connected onto the wall. Aranea. He's going to be spotted taking that ward down. He's a bit of a juicy target here with that red buff on.
Yeah, as well as the Oracle's Elixir. So not only would they be able to steal those buffs away, they'd be able to get down that Oracle's, clear out the ward. What we've been seeing the entire time the siege is going on, Stand United is available, and Kurt being played, or playing Shen, is of course split pushing on the side. The charm hits Livik, it's not the ideal target. And right now, Alternate are going to need Shen to join the party or wait for that Chain of Corruption to land.
Here we go, straight in on towards Makata. He gets charmed up as well. He's a dead man. It's Creaton that picks up that kill, goes 6-4-5. But what can they make of this one now? They've got the jungler down.
And not only that, they've still got Shen split pushing. So now you have Ultimate with the numbers advantage in the mid lane. They have Shen on the inner turret in the bottom lane. The signal is for Baron, and they do have vision of the jungle. So if Kuban does decide to come and challenge, they will be aware of it. But they're going to be leaving Kerb to split push. The rest of Meteor Makers are trying to set up a 4v4. Whoever catches the other players first will win this engagement. And you've got to remember that Jerry can Crow Storm at any point. He's channeling it up. Here comes the Crows.
Crow Storm coming in. Kuban feared directly into the rest of the team. He is going to be a dead man from this one. Does manage to get the Rune Prison down onto Jerry. Not really the target that he would have wanted for that one. And they push straight through for another kill. It was a trap, of course. Baron not really started off from that. But look at the gold here, Quick Shot. 300 the difference. And we're still tied on turrets.
Yeah, it's very, very close. And it's showing in terms of items. Each team has the ability to kill one another. But Alternate have been winning the last two or three team fights. They're now setting the tempo of this game. A very, very good bait, as it were, onto Baron. They pulled the members of MYM up. Jerry was hoping for more MYM guys to be in his Crow Storm, but it was only Kuban that they could jump onto. But they got his killing spree, got a couple of gold off of that, which will obviously play into their favor. And a very failed flash from Kuban. He tried to get closer to the Lantern to, you know, get to safety. And unfortunately, as he got there, he was just feared and silenced, and he could do nothing about it.
Not good news for him. Let's have a look down the items once again. Both Ferelden Lord and Charo now with a death cap in hand. See the Void Staff and that Athene's for Ferelden Lord on the other side. Just the Blasting One and that Tear stacking up for Charu Syndra.
So we'll most likely see that become a Seraph's Embrace. It'll give him that additional shield that'll help survive any burst that comes out from Ferelden Lord if he's caught out by the charm. And of course survive any of those auto attack damage that's coming down from Creighton. I most likely think that Ferelden Lord's going to go into a Deathfire Grasp next. It's an item we see picked up on Ahri's all the time. Get that cooldown reduction and just get that burst. Land a charm, followed up with DFG, then follow up everything else. So you still get that massive, massive burst as the damage and charm isn't necessarily the greatest. And then everything that follows up gets all that damage amplification thanks to the item.
So what's the plan here for Meteor Makers? We're going to see Maklo Security's Red Puff. Libic now with the Oracle on is going to be trying to clear some things out. And it looks like Shen is going to be going after all, after what we said earlier, towards our Wit's End.
So that's very unique. This is something that we haven't seen from Shen's in an extremely long time. I mean, I'm thinking back to before IPL 5, Season 2 times, when Shen's were built with those Wit's End up in the top lane if they did get ahead. Kerp at 1-0-11. You can't blame him. A stun onto Jayree. They've caught that Araneia.
Yeah, a lot of damage there onto Jayree. Here comes the teleport as well. Araneia knocked up by the depth charge that was going through onto Creighton. But there is that Lee Sin almost getting away. Libic actually gets the final tick of damage coming out. But look at Creighton. Makata going very low. And Ferelden Lord coming in from the backside. Maklo is dead in midair there. It was halfway gone into his into the jungle via the lantern. Oh, but Ferelden Lord. Wow. That's
Stand
a
United.
Big face check coming in. Stand United will come down, and the taunt comes in as well. He managed to land it on all three of them. Libic's not going to have the damage here, I don't think, to get rid of Ferelden Lord. He will die to Ferelden, and it's now Kubon versus Kerp, and Kubon is basically headed into no man's land right now. He's going to go into the top side of that jungle. Might be lucky enough somehow to get away from this, but I doubt it.
Well, we do see Creighton moving through the jungle, but what a fantastic fight for Alternate. They were caught out 4-2 in the mid lane. They managed to not only get away with it a little bit, they lost two members while picking up four. It was just perfect positioning and placement. Now, Creighton still thinks he's going to be able to cut him off, actually decides just to steal away the Wraith Camp, manages to get to safety, and a very good fight from Alternate. They landed the abilities they needed to. We lost track of Makla as he was flying through the air on the lantern because he was being killed by Ahri and flying through the air while he did it.
Yeah, and the funny thing is about all this fighting that we've had going on here, I mean, it's 19-13 in kills at this point. It's still 3-3 in turrets. They've not been able to push down any turrets recently.
And it's basically because of the farm numbers. Ryze, because he's been sitting and had so much time alone in lane, he's 50 CS over Shen. You've got Graves, who's 30 CS over Varus. And I've just noticed on that last back from Ferelden Lord, he's picked up a Hextech Revolver and a Longsword. Libic's been caught.
Yeah, Libic caught out here. He's going to get kicked back by Araneia, but he flashes away from it. And now they turn around on towards Araneia. The snipe almost catching him from Creighton from that backside. Ferelden Lord's charm misses. He just dashes in there, but they're not able to pick up a kill. And again, a lot burnt on that one, with not a lot coming from it.
This is something we love to see from teams, that they are not afraid to just use their abilities, albeit they weren't able to pick up the kill. It does show an intent to do anything possible. Jayree might be in trouble if Charu gets a good stun. But he doesn't. So nothing happens.
Not quite. And Jayree just saunters on back in.
The burst plus the damage from Baron would probably have been enough to kill Jayree, even with that HP he's got from the Kindle Gem. Just want to quickly touch. It looks like Ferelden Lord is making his way towards the Hextech Gunblade. Because of that Longsword and the Hextech Revolver, it's the only logical thing I can think of that'll eventually upgrade out of that.
Well, let's have a look then, see where he decides to go with that one. Right now, I'm gonna be clearing out. He's up to 270 minions almost. That's a good chunk away from Syndra, but we get into that point of the game where, you know, the farm numbers, well, of course they mean something because it means the extra items coming in there at the end of the day, but now another 10 minutes in this one and everyone's going to be pretty much fully built anyway.
Yeah, and the fact that both teams are still so incredibly close, even though Alternate have been winning the previous team fights, MYM just needs to pick a better engagement. They're trying to catch out Alternate, and with a Shen on their team, anybody they catch just gets Stand United and joins the party and they carry on fighting. So I don't think that's the right way forward. And I think MYM are talking right. How do we catch them out? What do we need to do? Where do we need to position? And I think wards will be the key here. Put some wards down, get vision control, and then jump on Alternate when they're not expecting it.
Now we see it. We are going to have Curb going back into that bottom lane. We'll try and get that turret down, being the
split pusher. Oh, they've caught for Elenlord.
They've caught for Elenlord, and they're going to go straight in on top of him. But Libic taking a lot of damage there. He got a good box down. But now Kerp is in there with that Stan United, and it's going to be a double kill coming out for Creighton. Can they get any more from this? Aranea does land the Q onto Charu, but decides not to follow through.
So the way they were fighting, the minions were able to pick up the tower. It ends up trading 1-2. So again, MYM losing out that engagement. Another thing is that they've lost the tower as well, actually. So we'll see how this pans out for them. That split push in Shen finally paying dividends. Took a very long time for him to get that bottom lane tower down, but it is down now. And I think Ferenold's going to go for a Lich Bane after he's gone for this Hextech Gunblade. He's going to have some additional attack damage, combo with the movement speed and the proc that Lich Bane's going to give you. That's a pretty big bursty champion in that regard.
Definitely scary, and if there's anyone who knows how to play, probably would be Ferenold. I don't know how many times he's been in this position with an Ahri. Maybe not quite at this magnitude of play with alternate versus Meaty Makers playing for the top spot in the LCS Summer Split here in Europe. Let's have a look through some of the other items then. Runic Bulwarks on both sides. The AD carries now both have an Infinity Edge and a Blade of the Ruined King each. However, if you look towards Varus, Phantom Dancer is done, only Azeal on the other side, and he's already got the workings of what will be, I'm guessing, that Last Whisper.
Yeah, so 250 attack damage on Varus to the 230 on Graves. Varus, of course, will be able to deal more sort of prolonged burst damage. I know it's a terrible term, but he's going to hit Blight Stacks on multiple people and then hit them. Teleport's coming in from Cho. He's motoring.
Oh, he's got the Home Guard boots on there, and he's going to try and get in on top of Ferelonlord, but look at that. Popped.
He missed. That's the whole thing. Charu jumped in there. He tried to use Scatter the Weak to stun up Ferelonlord, and it didn't work. It's not over. Libic's been caught too.
Oh, that charm not quite landing, but Aranea does land the Q onto Cubone. He's got a Banshee's Veil, but Mokata, he's going to go down. It's Creighton that picks that one up, and that's three men dead. This is surely a Baron for alternate.
Now, MYM tried to make a play. They tried to make something stick, and it backfired. It did not work. Charu, 3-7-9, somehow not able to have those epic performances against alternate. At 35 minutes on the clock, the Baron buff has been secured, and that's pretty much going to hit a big now what do we do button for MYM, because alternate have won, I think, every single team fight for the last 12 or 15 minutes.
Yep, and now with that Baron buff on, they're going to be starting to push things out here once again. Let's see what they can actually do with that one. Funny thing is, in that last fight, which we didn't really see, Cubone teleported in to the backside of them, ran through the alternate jungle, realized he wouldn't get anything, then ran back towards his Tri-Bush. It was a bit of a comedy of errors coming out there as the hook does land on towards Libic, but he's going to go down here for Ferelonlord. Not scared of getting right in there inside the base. Now he has to get away. It leaves Kerp. He's pretty damn tanky, though. He's taking a hell of a beating.
Unleash power.
And he will survive that just about.
So the shield from Lee Sin managing to keep him alive. The safeguard then followed that up with a feint of his own shield. Jayri is getting very, very close to having that Locket of the Iron Solari completed. So with that shield as well, even if you get close enough to killing alternate, they're going to have those survival mechanics. They're going to have those shields to help them out. And that is a full locket ahead of his opponents. There is no locket sitting on the side of MYM.
That would be then two lockets ahead, because we've seen both Jayri and Aranea pick up a locket there as well. We did see the Phage being picked up by Shen on his return home. So just overall, a very, very scary alternate right now. The Sheen is there as well, which I'm not sure if that was there before and I just missed it, but he's obviously working himself nicely up towards that Trinity Force. Kind of refreshing to see a Shen that's going this path as well.
You know what, when you're 3-0-15, I said this a little while ago, if you're in a power position, if you're comfortable with your team playing, comfortable with the decisions you're making, you can build damage. You can afford to go that route, because if your opponents aren't killing you like that yet, you're just going to be able to keep control of the matchup, and it's something that the entire alternate team is doing right now.
Well, another big pickup there. A Guardian Angel for Creighton's Varus. He's 11-4-8. He was romping ahead in the KDAs for as we came into this week at 28.7. That's gone down a bit, obviously, after that
Gambit
loss
have crushed
Gambit.
His dreams.
Yeah, they crushed his KDA dreams. But he's doing a good job of actually pushing it back here.
So take a look at the positioning here for Jerry and Aranea. They're wanting to set up a play. We're talking about the champions and sort of how they're going to scale. Yes, Ryze and Syndra will do very well as we get later and later in the game, but Shen's going to become unkillable. Aranea on Lee Sin maybe falls off a little bit in terms of the damage front, but will become a very beefy, tanky person. And Varus is always going to offer more to a team than Graves. Basically, because Graves and Syndra can't pop somebody instantly with all those shields with a GA, it's very, very difficult for MYM to win team fights now.
So here we go. The front line actually getting stunned up there by Syndra. The ultimate comes out, but most of it dodging. Only half of Frelon Lord's health gone by that, and that is not a good sign for Meteor Makers.
Also, in just one single camp of Wolves, Frelon Lord goes from 45% HP to full, thanks to the Spell Vamp,
you say?
Yep, Spell Vamp from that Hextech Gunblade, from her passive on every 10th proc of damage dealt, etc., as well as now Lifesteal. So it's going to add that as well. Sitting on a BF sword, so that'll most likely become a BFG. My prediction for items has been way off for Frelon Lord because hell, who builds a gunblade on Ahri?
Well, apparently Frelon Lord
does.
As I said before, if anyone knows how to build it in this position, probably would be him. 10-3-8 currently, with the most farm in the game at 331. Right now, Alternate looking to get in on towards his bottom turret. The hook actually did land there onto Frelon Lord, but not followed through by Livik. Probably a wise choice.
Yeah, even though they got that ability to land, they don't really have that insta-gib potential, but look at that. Charu is in insta-gib range.
And he's dead. That's another one. I feel like I've said that a lot today because these compositions that we have between these two teams.
Makata
gets hit there with the charm. The piercing arrow comes through, and look at Jerry. He's right in there. He gets the fear onto Kubon, who's kicked back by Aranea. Then they switch off and go towards Libic. Kubon's running for dear life. Frelon Lord, though, wants to get the kill on this. Libic did go down to Aranea. Can Frelon Lord track him down? He knows where he is. And it's just a case of trying to catch up and getting health back from the red buff as he goes by.
Plus 80, plus 40, plus 40, just on, you know, every single ability used. Kubon is taking us on a wild goose chase. He's very shortly going to get his ultimate up, which will give him a movement speed boost. But while that is happening, the split push is happening in the mid lane. The tower is down, as is the inhibitor. And now they're going to jump onto this bottom lane inhib turret.
Yep, going in for that one. Kubon is still running, but there's the ultimate for Frelon Lord. And there is a dead Ryze. Frelon Lord really, really, really wanted that kill. Probably would have been better for him if he actually just came back from that, because he was the one doing more damage than Kubon could have put out to stop that push coming in. But either way, this is going to be inhibitor turret number two, as they managed to hook Jerry in there. What Alternate turn it round. Makata loses a third of his health, but now Alternate finally do back away.
Charu.
Here comes Charu, teleporting for him. He's going to nuke down Jerry, but he's a dead man himself. It's Creaton that picked up another one. Makata now right in the thick of them. Makla's going to come in. Guardian Angel of Creaton is popped, and Meet Your Mate, Alternate, have stayed their welcome a little bit too long, and now they fix their attention on towards Kerp. He goes down, triple kill for Makla, but is it going to be too much, too little, too late?
Here comes Frelon Lord. No ultimate available, but it will be very, very soon, and I have to feel that it is too little, too late. Even with all of that gold that was just picked up, they use absolutely everything in their power to get items down and or to get kills down, and it just didn't feel very important. Libic now caught by Frelon Lord.
Yeah, Frelon Lord has picked up Azonya's Hourglass. We've seen the Trinity Force of Shen finished, a Twin Shadows for Fiddlesticks. There was one more in there somewhere, which I can't quite put my finger on right now.
Last Whisper for Varus.
Yeah, Last Whisper for Varus. That's the one. Which, yeah, just another three or four items that just make them even more ridiculously strong.
So the one thing that does play a little bit into MYM's favor is that now they have the Voidstaff picked up on Ryze as well. So he's already very beefy and tanky thanks to that Seraph's Embrace. All the mana going to help build him up his shield. He's got the HP from both the Banshee's Veil as well as that Rod of Ages. Now he's going to deal more damage thanks to Voidstaff. We also see a Runic Bulwark and Phantom Dancer picked up for MYM. But they're 10,000 gold behind. They've lost an inhibitor in the mid lane, the tower in the bottom lane, and they're going to be forever in base defending until those super minions stop shoving them down the middle.
Yep, we do have Baron, of course, up here in just 5 seconds' time, and as such, Jerry got it pink warded. And Libic misses one of the easier hooks that I think he could have this game. Obviously, having full vision of that one. Creaton going to get himself the red buff, and he's going to come back up because this Baron may just end up in a fight which could end the game. We're 43 minutes into this one right now.
In addition, the mid lane for Alten is pushed all the way down to the inhibitor turret. So if MYM were to win a convincing team fight in and around the Baron pit, they're close enough to the inhibitor to actually shove it down and rush it down, especially with all the attack damage that Graves will be dealing. Right now, though, look at Forbidden Lord. Look at Aranea. Stand United is up. They may be deciding to pick a fight. They've caught Forbidden Lord!
They're going to get Forbidden Lord here. Stand United does come in onto him, but look at the damage that they're putting out here. Libby going to go down, surely. Charu is going to be chased in. Forbidden Lord going for that one. Makla will die on the return of the Prism, and now it's Charu being chased. Will he die? No! The Rune Prism from behind Forbidden Lord somehow staying alive. Aranea shields him up. Kerb will dash in there for the kill. For the double kill, and that is the ace here for Alternate, and surely the game.
And Kerb does that for style points too. The flash into Taunt plus Vorpal Blade, landing all of the damage there on Charu, closing it out, even with an awesome, awesome hook from Libic onto Forbidden Lord's Ahri. It was not enough. He was able to get those shields, get that lifesteal back, and dive the hell out of that fight with his ultimates.
Fantastic game coming out, and that's, as you said, the one that we were expecting last week when they met, when they were 4-0 apiece. But now Alternate, well, they've won another one here. They are now 6-1 at the top of the European LCS Summer Split, and they can be very happy about that. Who would have thought it that at this stage in, after 7 games, they'd have 6 W's next to their name? And, well, what a performance it came with as well. The stats don't lie, I'm afraid. Creighton 14-5-9. Forbidden Lord 13-3-11.
I tell you what, whoever has to face off against Forbidden Lord will be thinking about those performances, will be thinking about how much of an impact he's had. We've been talking about Alternate MYM and how their games have been. I think in the EU LCS, Alternate have got the strongest team fights out of all of the teams.
That is a very brave statement, but they have the stats to back it up right now. Top of the league, 6-1. I guess we can't really argue with it at this stage, but we've still got a long way to go in this season. But that's it from us here on the Caster Desk for now. We're going to head over to the analysis desk where Demon and Jason are going to break it all down.
Thank you very much, Joe and Trevor. Wow, what a game. Craziness for a while. I mean, first of all, I just want to look through my notes because I can see 4-1 to MYM, Dragon, Flash Hook, 2-0, 5-1 to Alternate, Dragon for MYM, back and forth action. Another Baron gets taken, Kubon goes down, Dragon for Alternate, 4-2 for Alternate, win Dragon fight, MYM land the hook, 2 go down. It's just back and forth, non-stop action. And for Forbidden Lord against Charu, what a battle for the ages.
That was, it's like two of the strongest mid laners right now in Europe. I'm a little bit bold to say that, but going head-to-head right there with Charu with his teleport, using that very well with home guarded boots. There we go. Yeah. It was on the tip of my tongue. Home guard boots to really open up some plays, which unfortunately didn't work out, but Hextech Gunblade, wow. Whoever thought it would do that much damage?
Well, I mean, it seemed to work well, and it's interesting because obviously, you know, Charu was kind of known for being on Ahri, who seemed to work very well for him, but Forbidden Lord just turned around and said, I can play that champion just as well as you can.
That's one of the champions he used getting up to 3,000 ELO in Season 2, so...
And the thing is, I mean, that was ballsy play from Charu, because he picked Syndra last. And Syndra into Ahri, well, there wasn't really a pun in there, but I can see where you're going from. But, I mean, that's a tricky game, because that's skill shots versus effectively someone that's going to dash into you and all those balls are going to be on your face. That was not intended either.
So first he plays with this. No, that was, whatever. But anyway, so I think what the idea of their composition was actually to hook someone. Go in.
Keep it together. Come on.
Go in. Have Kubon lock someone down with this Rune Prison, and then Charu just blows him up.
Yeah, like, absolutely. Because there was the double hooks. There was the Thresh and the Nautilus going to try and throw all the hooks in there, which we have actually seen already working out for them. We know we've seen some absolute tremendous team play from both of these. I mean, picks and bans, I think they kind of had it right. They took out the Sandra, so they had to take that away. But honestly, I mean, I thought Meet Your Makers actually had it for a while, but Alternate, and again, Aranea, we saw him in the mid. He was... you know, essential in a couple of those kills for Forbidden Lord early on to Charu to get that ball rolling.
Right, and the thing is, it's we saw them meet last time, obviously last week, and they were very aggressive towards each other. They were really heavy into fighting. We saw Meet Your Makers, they would ward up the enemy jungle of Alternate, then Alternate's like, okay, well, we're just going to fight on your side of the jungle anyways. And then we saw Gambit play Alternate yesterday, where how did Gambit beat them? By taking their aggression and just matching it and then surpassing it just as well as they could. And Alternate, they kind of went a little bit of, in my mind, of Giants, where it's Control Chaos.
Yeah.
Like back when Giants beat Gambit, you know, I believe it was in week one, the Spring Split, it's just Control Chaos. So you see them constantly fighting, trying to make these plays happen. And it's just every single time that you think, oh, this person's caught on Alternate, or oh, this person's caught on Mitri Makers.
There's a counter.
The whole team comes out of the woodworks for them, and they just like completely turn it around on you. So it was really cool to see that, because it's really hard to have communication like that and to understand like what you're going to do or what my other person's going to do, and to be able to back that up. Because I guarantee, like, they just know how each other play now. And
yeah.
They're able to make that work for them. And
we saw it also when Alternate played Gambit yesterday, just how that controlled aggression, it seems to work in their favor. But what a crazy, crazy game. Actually, Meet Your Makers kind of go that way. And we actually discussed it before, if I remember rightly, the Meet Your Makers game, when they did pick up the win earlier yesterday, was how they like to get a little bit of control. They like to take the towers. They like to push you early. They didn't get a chance to do that against Alternate.
Yeah, it's... If I remember correctly, Mitri Makers took like every single first turret of the game, except like one or two, well, obviously in the matches they lost now. But yeah, they like to have that control.
Scatter the wards.
Yeah, and they like to take the game relatively early on. They like to control when they get out of the laning phase. But Alternate just said, all right, well, we're not going to let you. We're not going to let you get to that point where you can control us, because you want the team to react to you when you're playing like this, when you're being really aggressive. You don't want to react to how the other team's playing, which both teams, we saw this, what game is it? Actually, it was Gambit and Alternate yesterday, where both teams were constantly trying to push that boundary of, no, we want you to play reactive. And then the other team's like, no, we want you to play reactive. And they kept butting heads consistently. But it just seemed like Alternate just had a little bit more awareness, I don't know, like a little bit more game sense, where they just got like one or two extra plays in, like in terms of positioning, they're in the right spot, and they're able to snowball that really well. And like you said, you're going through your notes, just fights back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and yet it was still a very close game the entire time.
Absolutely fantastic stuff. And of course, as always, we are going to have an interview, and it will be a Costa Rica shot.